Ionic compounds are formed by the strong attraction between the oppositely charged species, typically a metal cation and a non-metal anion. However, also, ionic compounds are formed between polyatomic ions, and you'll need to become familiar with those. First of all, you need to remember what the word cation means and the word anion. Well, take sodium, for example. The sodium atom has 11 protons and 11 electrons. The protons are compactly housed in the nucleus, whereas the electrons are outside the nucleus in some diffuse space. If the sodium atom loses one electron, you will form the sodium ion, or a cation of sodium. Because you've lost one electron, you now still have 11 protons, but only 10 electrons, so that ion is carrying a plus one charge. For an anion, take chlorine as an example. For the neutral atom chlorine has 17 protons in the nucleus and 17 electrons residing outside the nucleus in a diffuse cloud. If you add one electron to the chlorine atom, you will have a chloride anion. You still have 17 protons in the nucleus, but now you have 18 electrons residing in the cloud outside the nucleus. This gives the ion overall net charge of minus one. So cations are formed by the loss of electrons, and anions are formed by the gain of electrons. You should ask yourself why ions are formed in the first place. And you also ought to wonder if you can predict whether or not a cation will be formed or an anion will be formed and what charge it might carry. Well, the reason why ions are formed is pretty much the same reason why a ball rolls down a hill. The electrons are moving to a lower energy state, just like a ball is moving to a lower gravitational potential energy. And you can predict whether or not a particular element is tending to form a cation or anion and what its charge is based on its position in the periodic table. You see, the electrons that are moving around when ions are formed are the electrons on the surface of the atom. The electrons on the surface or the outer shell of the atom are called the valence electrons. And chemistry occurs with these valence electrons. Electrons are either going to be lost, gained, or shared upon a chemical change. So the valence electrons, the number of valence electrons can be predicted by the position on the periodic table. As it turns out, let's just think about the representative elements, the A series elements from the periodic table. 1A, 2A. The number in front of the letter A indicates the number of valence electrons in each one of those groups. So the 1A has all the elements in this group have one valence electron. In group 2A, they all have two valence electrons, 7A7 and 8A8. And what we know is we can predict the type of chemistry those elements will undergo based on the number of electrons. Now, the B series down here, the transition elements down here, they're a little bit more difficult to predict the number of valence electrons and their chemistry, so we'll reserve that for a more advanced course. For now, just looking at the representative or the A groups, we can definitely predict the number of valence electrons. Now, as it turns out, there's something about the group A, 8A elements, the noble gases. They have 8 electrons in their valence shell, and they're very stable. They tend not to lose, gain, or share electrons. And what we find is all the other elements in the periodic table tend to lose, gain, or share electrons, such that they will have the same valence electrons as the noble gases. All right, so that's the movement of electrons that we see. So by knowing the number of valence electrons, we can predict the type of ion that's going to be formed. In the case of the metals, metals tend to lose electrons to form cations. So the representative elements, for example, sodium. Let's take a look at this sodium. This very elementary electron configuration image is trying to indicate where the electrons reside around the sodium nucleus. What you can see from this image is that there's one electron in the outermost shell, and we would predict that because sodium exists in group 1a right here. So we predict that it has one valence electrons in its shell. And since it's a metal, it tends to lose electrons to form a cation. And when it does, its valence shell now has 8 electrons, which is similar to a noble gas, which is more stable. So the electron is going to move away, if there's a place for it to go, to form a more stable cation. In this case, it's a cation with a +1 charge. Now here's an example. The electron has to go someplace, and in this case it's going to reside on a chlorine atom. And chlorine, you can see the valence shell has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 valence electrons. We would expect that based on the position of chlorine in the periodic table. Chlorine is right here in group 7, so we predict that it has 7 valence electrons. So it's going to pick up that one electron to become a -1 anion, the chloride anion. And so then what we have here is a positively charged cation and a negatively charged anion that will be held together by a strong electrostatic attraction. Okay. Or the Lewis symbols are a shortcut way to visualize electron arrangements. And once we visualize these electron arrangements, we can better predict the types of ions that would be formed. Oh, there's a mild typo here. This sulfur should be down here. So this is just a few of the representative elements: hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, etc. And the Lewis symbol is a shorthand way to visualize the electron arrangement of the valence shell. So hydrogen, of course, is right here on the periodic table. It's in group 1, so we know it has 1 valence electron. Lithium is just below it on the periodic table. It also has 1 valence electron. So the Lewis symbols are a way to visualize the number of electrons in the valence shell, which then helps you predict the type of bonding that will exist. Sodium, just below lithium, all in group 1. Beryllium and magnesium are in group 2, and so we can visualize them as having 2 valence electrons. Boron, and it doesn't quite matter where you put these valence electrons as long as you get the right number around the atoms. And so the boron and aluminum both have 3 valence electrons, and so you can start beginning to understand why the chemistry within the groups or families is similar, because the chemistry is all about what's going on with the valence electrons, and the number of valence electrons is going to dictate the type of chemistry that we see, or at least be able to predict. So group 5 has 5 valence electrons. You see nitrogen and phosphorus from group 5, which would be right here, nitrogen and phosphorus on the periodic table. Oxygen, pardon the typo here with the sulfur out of place, has 6 valence electrons, as does sulfur. So those would be found here in the periodic table. Fluorine and chlorine are both halogens, and they have 7 valence electrons, so the Lewis symbol would show those 7 valence electrons. And those two, whereas neon has 8 valence electrons, argon has 8 valence electrons, etc. So based on these valence electrons and these Lewis symbols, we can predict the types of bonding that will exist. Right now we're talking about ionic bonds. So the metal is going to lose an electron in order to achieve a noble gas electron configuration, and the nonmetal will gain electrons in the case of the ionic bonds. Now hydrogen only needs to doesn't need to have 8 valence electrons. It only needs to have 2. Helium is satisfied with 2. Lithium tends to lose 1 to come back to 2. So those elements around helium will change such that they look like helium, and beyond that, they change such that they have 8 valence electrons. Let's take another look at an example here. Here's calcium and chlorine. What type of bonding will we predict if we have calcium and chlorine? Is right below magnesium on the periodic table, and so we would predict that it is a metal, and it has 2 valence electrons. And chlorine is in group 7, so it has 7 valence electrons. It's a nonmetal. So what we predict is that the calcium is going to lose its electrons to get down to a valence shell of 8, and the chlorine only needs to pick up 1. So what happens is, in the case of the compound of calcium chloride, is that one of the electrons will reside with the chlorine and the other with the other chlorine, and you will end up with a calcium ion and two chloride ions. And the way we write that formula correctly is like this: calcium chloride. And you can see now that the chlorine each has 8 electrons. Here's its extra. And they both would have a minus one charge. The calcium has lost 2, so it's now carrying a plus 2 charge. And the ionic compound that's formed is calcium chloride. So you can predict the charge of the ion based on its position on the periodic table. All the other group 1 elements tend to form an ion with a plus 1 charge, the group 2 with a plus 2 charge, the group 3 with a plus 3 charge. Group 8 tends not to form any kind of bonding because it's stable. Group 4 tends not to form ions. Should it lose 4? Should it gain 4? Which way should it go? It tends not to form ions. Group 5, now we're clearly into the nonmetals here, tends to gain 3 electrons to get a minus 3 charge. Group 6 tends to gain 2 electrons to end up with a minus 2 charge. Group 7 tends to gain 1 electron to end up with a minus 1 charge. 8, nothing. And 4 elements from group 4 tend to form covalent compounds. So they're not going to end up with a charge typically. The transition metals, it's a little bit more difficult. They do form cations, but we're not predicting at this point what they are. It's very difficult. But for the others, we can, and you need to memorize that. It helps you understand ionic compounds and charges. Okay, so based on the position on the periodic table, you can predict whether or not it's going to be an ionic or a covalent compound. Metals and nonmetals together in a compound, you will predict that you have an ionic compound. Nonmetals with nonmetals, covalent compounds. That will be the subject of another video.